Well, I couldn't quite go to sleep without doing a little bit of investigating. What I did is flipped the chassis on its side and got a voltmeter in there. And what I quickly discovered by going between the ground and positive side of that cap is we got about 10 volts DC, about 60 volts AC. And that roasting smell I was smelling was not the thermistors, which are barely warm. I just had to set on a moment ago. And these big power resistors, which I overrated a bit, are barely warm. What fried or what was getting toasty is that 1K resistor down there that goes between B plus and that point. That's that 1K decoupling cap between B plus and a few other circuits. So that was a 350 volt cap, but DC, not meant to have AC across it. So what is possibly going on here? Well, of course I could have made a wiring error, but remember we have B plus disabled, so where the heck could voltage be coming from? Well, one side of the chassis is going to the AC line, and the other side goes through all the tube filaments. What I suspect has happened is this is shorted somewhere to the filament string about halfway through. So we're getting about half of the AC line on this point. How could that happen? Well, a wiring error, which seems a little unlikely. What seems more likely is that one of the tubes perhaps has a heater to cathode short. Because remember, I didn't test any of the tubes. That's a real, real bad thing to have happen in a series strung set. To have tube elements short out, because you can get the AC line or some fraction of it going into circuits where it should not be. So I can certainly test the tubes, but I'll also check out the wiring as well. Now, that point doesn't go to a whole lot of stuff, but I should also check to make sure that there isn't AC on the other side of that 1K resistor. That would be really bad, because that's B plus for the whole set, and that could have damaged some of the other caps. So I'm hoping it's isolated to this point, and that 1K resistor was actually protecting it from feeding back to the rest of the set. So what does this go to? This wire goes over to the tuner. This wire goes over to the horizontal circuitry. So we are talking about this point. So it goes to the horizontal ringing coil and through 1.8 meg resistor to 10DE7. Is that right? No, off a little bit, sorry. Oh man, it goes way there over there, 820K to the audio output tube. So that's a huge resistor. That's going to limit current. This coil and a 15K 1 watt resistor. That all seems a little unlikely to be shorting to any filament strength through that stuff. Now remember, this is a little bit of a modification. So in my version, this is also going over this way. So that's the 1K resistor that's frying. So it goes to the tuner. So perhaps there's an issue in the tuner or with one of the tubes in the tuner. Now I can't just pluck a tube out, because if I do that, then they all go out. So either swap tubes, I got a few spares over here, or take them all out and test them all for shorts. And I'll do some resistance checking and then so on too. Could be a little tedious to track down. Or not. Well, I very quickly determined something. I measured resistance from this point over to the filament droppers and got 45 ohms. that's way, way, way too low. That's like measuring the resistance through one or two tubes. So there's got to be a short between this point and the tube filament string. Where or where might that be? This loops around and goes into this harness. Well, I will disconnect this, and that will isolate the tuner from the equation. I isolated the tuner. The problem remained, which only left one wire going from that point to anything. And that is this right here. Now, when I rewired this, almost all the wires are very brightly colored plastic insulation. And I compared them to a reference chassis. Except for these two. These are cloth covered. And they go right near each other. And I was pretty darn sure I'd gotten these right, that the orange striped one goes to this point. Wrong. I have them flip-flopped. This point goes directly to the tube filament string. Goes right into this guy and then all the other tubes. Whereas this is the power that goes into that remaining coil. So if I flip those two around, replace that cap, should be alright. I'm very grateful that that 1K resistor was in there, because I'll have to replace that too, because I think that saved there from being a whole lot more damage. Continuing on now with the Holiday project, I clipped out the offending cap. Strictly speaking, I don't need it because it was actually in parallel with this guy up here. I just wanted to give some filtering on this side and on this side as well. We'll replace it eventually, but don't need it to get this set operational. What I have done is I remounted the controls here for volume, contrast, and power, and kind of secured those DEX control assembly was kind of falling apart. Reattached the antenna terminals, got a fusible resistor in there. Of course, I fixed my wiring mistake. What I want to try doing now is a power up with no CRT connected, and I popped the cap off the plate lead. I don't have the yoke connected. Maybe not the best thing to do, the vertical output circuit, but let's see if we can get a crackle out of the speaker. Oh yeah, and I have a touch speaker hooked up. So, contacts. Something's not quite right. So we actually don't have any current draw. Well, I got that in the on position. Oh, I didn't reinstall the 6CG7. Just try that again. Ah, there we go. No, something's still not quite right. Good reason why the tubes weren't lighting up. One of the tuner tubes is missing. These filaments should have never lit up. So when they were lighting up before, it's just because the AC was passing through that capacitor. Let me see if I can dig one up. I killed the B+ again. I just want to see if I can get all these tubes to light up properly. That's looking better. At least the current draw is about what it should be. And the tubes are glowing. Stupid pilot light's out again, though. Yeah. Jiff lights. All tubes are glowing. Current draw's a little... Well, it's higher than it was before. It's actually about 0.65. And that makes sense because I'm just shorting out with a CRT filament. It should be that load being in there. We'll cut it down a bit. And also remember, the thermistors I have in there have a really low on resistance, about a third of what it should be. So when I get the proper thermistors in there and put the CRT load in series. Let's get the current draw down where it should be. All right, so that's cool. All right. And this switch does actually work. Janky though it may be. Okay, so I'm gonna get the B plus hooked back up again, and this time I'll put a voltmeter on it to make sure that I've got about what it should be, which should be around 275. Full power test meter on the main B plus output, usable resistor in place, speaker hooked up, and here we go. Or not. Oh. Oh. Stupid light went out again. Definitely get in there and clean that contact. Current draw is like 1.5 amps. It's a little high. B plus is low and dropping. There is a little bit of crackle out of the speaker though. But no tuner action. B plus a little low, get up to 117. Current draw is like 1.25 amp. Seems reasonable. B plus of 233, that's a little low. Well, it's on drag. I was hoping to at least hear a little bit of a static crash when I change channels. So, take a guess. Anything in the tuner, IF. Sound output. I don't want to make the same mistakes that I made while working on the Siesta, namely to guess and just start swapping tubes and replacing parts. I do this methodically. Now, what led me to the problem with the vertical deflection of the Siesta was going through the SAMS resistance chart. So that's what I'm going to do here. And if that checks okay, then I'll go through and do the voltage chart. Got my laptop down here, but before I dive into that, something else I've been meaning to show you guys. Look at the glare. So, recently on eBay, somebody sold some Predict arms that had been re-brass plated. And it looks pretty good. But one thing I thought was interesting was this, which is a close-up he showed, or she showed, of one of the pieces that goes into the side of the set. They did that to show that there's a scuff on it. But what I thought was interesting is how rounded over it got. This is exactly what I was getting at in an older video when I was talking about my trepidation at sending these out. On the originals, all these edges are really crisp. It looks to me like the replater ground it down to get all the pits out and polish it up, and in the process, rounded over the details. That's what I'm afraid of. Anyway, so SAMS. I had alluded to the SAMS a few times as being interesting in that they laid things out a little bit more clearly in some aspects. So, for example, here's where the power comes in. You can very clearly see one side goes right to ground. That's the whole chassis. On the other side, we've got a power switch. There's that fusible resistor and the B-plus power supply. The other branch, there's our thermistor. And there's our 44 light bulb. The filament dropper with three sections. And then here is our series string of all the tube filaments. Very clearly laid out, I think. Except, of course, they made a mistake that the 13 and the 17 should be flip-flopped. But otherwise, I think it's a little bit easier to follow than on the original Philco service info. All right, so what do we care about? We care about the resistance chart. Ooh, there we go. I'll have to rotate that. Okay, if you've never seen one before, briefly, what this is every tube in the set with its pins, and typically it's the resistance between the ground in this case, the chassis, and that pin. Now you'll see throughout this various symbols, a dot, a cross, and so on. Those are all delineated down here. Sometimes they tell you to measure not to chassis ground, but to a different point, like the 280 volt. That's what I've been referring to as 275. Another minor difference between the SAMs and the Philco is what the actual B-plus voltage should be. They do both agree on that the lower B-plus is 140, and the final one, it's pin 3 of V12, whatever that may be. That would be the damper tube. So you got to be careful when you go through this about what you're measuring the resistance between. But it should immediately pinpoint any wiring errors that I might have, or any shorts or that type of thing. And I also want to go through, so here's the audio output transformer, make sure that that is okay. Vertical output transformer, make sure that's okay. Already checked the filter choke, that measured correctly. And I'll pick up from there. Well, that didn't take long. I thought I would start with 12CA5 audio output tube, the tube that was getting so hot. Checked pin 1, immediately found a problem. Pin 1 should have 68 ohms between it and the 140 volt bus. And it does. And then I went to check pins 2, 3, 4 to chassis ground, and they were all measuring infinite open. Then I wanted to make sure my meter was working right, so I went back and checked between pin 1 and chassis ground, and still got 68 ohms. In other words, the resistance between pin 1 and the 148 volt bus, or sorry, the resistance between pin 1 and the 140 volt bus was the same as between pin 1 and ground. So then I checked the resistance between the 140 volt bus and ground, and it was zero, essentially. That is the 140 volt bus. Goes through this orange wire, and it goes down to where that area was where the cap blew its top. So I think I got a problem down in there somewhere. So if the 140 volt bus is shorted, that would certainly pull down the mean 275 volt B plus. So let's take a look and see, where is that 140 volt bus? It's going right through here. And there's a 68 ohm resistor to pin 1, which is the cathode on the audio output tube. So that seems to be okay. So somewhere in here, I suspect it's shorted to ground. A couple possibilities. This may seem a bit odd, but the shielded cable going to the volume control, see, poking down here, that shield goes to the 140 volt bus, not ground. And I know this control's been replaced, so I wonder if they may have inadvertently connected that shield to ground somewhere. So I gotta check that. Now, why would that shield be going to 140 volts on that ground? I think it's because the cathode on the audio output tube is essentially on that 140 volt bus. And they want to keep the voltages kind of relative to each other. Why would they do that, not have this cathode grounded? Well, that gets a little more complicated into a stacked B plus design. They're probably using this audio output tube as a voltage divider. Class A operation tubes generally have pretty much constant current going through them. So 275 volt bus going through the primer of the audio output tube to the plate here. If this tube has a fixed bias, it's pretty much always drawing the same current, which means you get a fixed voltage drop here. So that's actually, I believe, where the 140 volts or so comes from. It's not coming from a divider somewhere else, it's coming through the audio output tube. So that's pretty critical to the operation of this set. So I gotta check that cable, and of course check these various points on the circuit board are probably all right, but eventually it leaves that circuit board and goes elsewhere. Looks like it goes into the tuner, or sorry, the video IF panel, so it could be a problem in there. Then it goes down to this filter cap, and this cap didn't blow, but it was next to the cap that blew. So I want to make sure that's okay. This is the resistor that was getting toasty, and the cap that blew was connected to this side of it. So if there was AC going through, because I connected up this point, I believe this is the point that I connected incorrectly, so it could have fed back through this 18K to water in the other way, and I might have taken that cap out and shorted it to ground. That would suck. I'm pretty sure I ordered two. I usually order two or more of every part, just in case something like this happens. So, if that cap is dead, I will have to replace it. Hopefully that, so I gotta, let's not get ahead of ourselves. I gotta figure out where the problem is on that bus. So how do we go about isolating this? Well, when I put these wires back on, I did it kind of loosely. I did not solder them in place. So it's quite easy for me to lift off the 140 volt line. Resistance from this stake to chassis is well above 0 ohms. From this wire to chassis, it's short. So I know the problem is somewhere down below on that orange wire. This is that orange wire. It used to go to this cap. I clipped the lug off and wrapped some electrical tape around it. This is the wire going to the shield of that volume control. This is a ceramic bypass cap. And this goes off to that 100 microfarad cap. Any one of these could be a problem. This cap could be bad. This cap could be bad. There could be short inside the shield. And there's an orange wire going off to the video IF board. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take everything off of this terminal light to break that down. But I think what I'll do first is unravel this and undo this mess. I got to clean it up at some point anyways. This cap is not critical. It's for like RF bypass. I could clip it out. Also seems very unlikely that that's the problem. I don't see the top of this bulging. I hope it's still good. I just cut that blob apart, chucked each one of these for resistance to ground. It's the shield on the audio cable. I had a feeling that might be it. So whoever rewired this control did it wrong. And I'll have to pop this back out. But they must have attached that shield somewhere on this harness to ground. I unmounted the control subassembly and the problem seemed to go away, so I started to reinstall it, paying more attention this time, and those terminals on the volume control are smashing right into a screw on the chassis. So I may have done that because I was trying to remember this bottom section was broken off when I first got it. And I kind of tightened down these locking sections. So perhaps when I did that, I think I can attach in several places because there are three of these around the perimeter. So I think I'll break that apart and then see if I can rotate it so that the lugs are pointing down towards the camera there. Well, this is a little annoying. I can see that somebody struggled a bit with replacing this control. Here's an original one. Went like that, so all the terminals are facing straight down. On this replacement, they're all facing the opposite way.
Well, some of them were off to the side when I hit it. That way. Why? Well, there's a hole drilled out through there for a locking thing. What I'm going to do for now is just leave it detached to get that short out of there. But then I think I will take a look at resurrecting this control. See if I can get that power switch working again. Well, I finally found a use for that one terminal strip here that only had one isolated lug on it. Perfect tie point for the 140-volt bus. Move the filter cap over here, tied all of it together there, put a new ceramic 470 picofarad cap on it. That's that. Also got rid of those teeny little thermistors and got the big guys in there. Let's try another power-up. Repairs are complete. Reinstalled the audio output tube, rehooked up the 140-volt wire. Got my voltmeter clipped in there so we can monitor it. Got the pitch tube hooked back up. Oh, in case you're wondering why this arm is white, I have it primered. I'm going to sand it down and use some metallic paint on it. More about that later. Right now, let's try powering this up again. Ah. Good. Tube's warming up, current draw is increasing. Hear the flyback buzzing. Current draw increasing more and more. Hey, we got a raster. Tweaking the brightness control. Now remember, that's not the right horizontal output tube. I have minimal expectations about anything. Adjusting the vertical hold, it seems to be doing something. That's good. How about some static? Still not much out of the speaker. Hey, but the tuner's doing something. In fact, looks like I might actually be receiving something. Horizontal is way off. Hey, we have reception. Let's see, local distance switch. So that's giving me a little more gain. It's a little more defined. Not for my antenna. I got like next to nothing. Just this cheesy little clipped on wires here. Got my converter box handy though, so let's get that going before I worry about picture quality. And we have no sound because I didn't hook a speaker up. Hang on. Okay, got a speaker hooked up now. Oh yeah, all sorts of static crackling there. Alright. Don't want to get busted, but... Oh yeah, we got sound. Cool. Well, always something new. So if it hadn't been for that stupid control shorting out and my one wiring mistake, would have saved a few hours, wouldn't have trashed a capacitor, but hey, getting there. So next step, get the right horizontal output tube. I know if I have any. I don't have many. Ah, perfect box to stumble across. Didn't take me too long to find it. This is a box full of tubes I bought from, I think it's ESRC in Florida. They sell tubes. Pretty reasonable prices, especially the Dollar Days section where they periodically sell tubes for $1 a piece, tubes that are not that popular. So I got a whole bunch of 6J6s and TV tubes. TV tubes generally are not that popular because the real money is in audio tubes and to some extent radio tubes. TV tubes, well, it's just not that big a hobby. So a lot of the tubes used in Predictas, both the 17 and 21 inch set, are only $1 each. Like there's a 5X8 tube, a mixer oscillator for the tuner, 9DR7, BR7, that's the sync separator tube, 6AW8 video output tube, and most importantly, I have a couple 12DQ6s, so let's get this popped in there and see how it works. Here we go again. Looks about the same. That's with the brightness up all the way. Oh, let's see, before I turn it off, I want to double check what my output voltage is. Unless it's drawing more current, it might have sagged a little. It's still 117. Drawing about an amp. So that all seems correct. All right, well, let's put a stronger signal source in there. You can see with the lights on, you can barely see anything. So definitely not a very bright picture. Also, I will replace the 1B3 horizontal rectifier tube. That is a very easy thing to do. Here's a look at the high voltage tube that was in there. It's Philco, and the plate cap was on quite firmly, so I suspect this is the original, which means it very probably is weak. Well, I dug up a new old stock Philco, so let's pop that in and give it a try. Here we go. Also got a converter box, so it should have a nice strong signal coming in. Be a little brighter. Certainly looks better. Still not as bright as I would like it to be, but watchable. I'm adjusting the contrast control. It doesn't seem to be doing a whole lot. Oh, there. It's just really hard to turn. Picture's pretty out of focus, too. Now, I don't remember back when I originally tested this picture tube how well it tested. But that's kind of how a bad picture tube would look, where it's kind of out of focus and dim. Well, if I turn the brightness down, it certainly looks better. But that can be an indication of a problem with high voltage power supply. So, another issue that can happen, when you turn the brightness up, it's drawing more current to the high voltage supply. There's something wrong with the high voltage supply, like a weak high voltage rectifier tube. trying to get more brightness will drag it down, lowers the high voltage, and the picture goes fuzzy. So that's a possibility. Seems a little less likely since I just put a new high voltage rectifier in now, and it's definitely better. That could also just simply be this picture tube's got to run for a while. It's been sitting for ages. I tested it like a year ago, and it's been sitting since. I don't know how many years or decades before that. So I'm just going to let this run for a while. Also, that is a jumper for the electrostatic focus. You can put it in one of two positions, either ground like it is now or in that position, which could improve the focus. So that's what we got now, kind of blurry. I also want to make sure the boost voltage is correct. I'll do that in a bit. Right now, a little tricky to do because I don't want to get shocked. Reach in here and I'm going to disconnect that focus. Alright, so it's not connected to anything right now. I'm going to try the other position. Seem to make a whole lot of difference no matter which side I use. Oh yeah, I think it is a little bit better on the higher potential. Let me turn the set off and hook it up more firmly and see what difference it makes. Oh yeah, that's definitely better. Nice. Cool. Actually working better than I expected it would be. I'll let it run for a while. Well, I did some poking around. I tried swapping another 12DQ6, swapped another 6CG7. Nothing was making any difference. I probed the high voltage. It's actually a little bit over 16,000. The schematic calls for 15,000, so fine with that. And the boost voltage is 400, which is exactly what it's supposed to be. So all signs indicate that it's a weak CRT, or possibly some of the other voltages on it are wrong, like G1 and G2. But the first thing I can do is retest it. And then there is that one way down there that I scavenged a few weeks ago or months ago. That kind of lit up the neck blue, which indicates there's gas inside, but it had great emissions and great cutoff, so we can try hooking that one up. That'll be a bit of work, though, because I got to dismantle this head unit to make that happen. Well, maybe we can try this out right now. I dug through my odds and ends and found a spare yoke CRT socket and high voltage lead that I think are all correct for a 21-inch set. Well, I'm sure the yoke is. It's a 21-inch set, so I'll have this T-bar on the side here. I'm pretty sure this is the right socket. We'll find out. So you may recall I did a little salvage video. Somebody had listed the guts from penthouse model, also known as the barber pole. He repurposed it into something. I'm not sure what he didn't show me, but somewhere along the road, the CRT was treated pretty roughly, and the key actually broke off, and the pins were a bit bent, so I think that's what let some gas in. When I tested it, it tested great, but the neck glowed purple, which means usually that nitrogen gas got inside. But what the hell? Let's see what happens. So, contact. Of course, if it works fine, we're not going to see anything because it's facing down, but we should see a glow out of the edge. Hey, the CRT lit up, or filament lit up. That's a huge plus. Doesn't appear to be doing much of anything. Let me check the connections for the high voltage. Jeez, the stupid fusible resistor had gotten knocked out of its socket when I took the high voltage box off or something like that. Alright, let's try this again. Ooh, we got some little fireworks show going on inside the gun there. There was sort of a raster on there briefly, but there was some arcing and some sparking inside the electron gun, and now it looks like she's done. That might have been the last gasp of a vacuum being eaten up, so to speak. Oh, well, there it goes again. That's kind of what I thought this might do. Well, I'm going to turn it off before we completely burn it out. I'll try to rig this up so this thing's on its side so we can actually see a better light show. I managed to prop it on its side. I'm going to turn off all the lights. And let's see what happens. That's pretty wild. Huh, so the arcing inside the gun may have been a bit of a mislead. It's a bad connection on the grounding loop. Oh, there's a nice smell of ozone in the air. So, aside from the fireworks, obviously we don't really have a focused image on the CRT. I don't know what exactly we can conclude from all that. Then we got a big black spot in the middle. And it is glowing purple inside, as I think you can see, which is not good. So I think that's why we've got the big black dot in the middle.